Already I'm getting questions and doubts from people. Swami, I tried to withdraw, tried to meditate. Then this happened and then that happened and I'm not sure what happened. So when you're not sure of what happened, it means nothing has happened. When you're sure that something has happened, you will know it has happened. But very important, there's a mala, vikshepa, avarana. All the three, when they are done away with, then only you have the realization of who you are. Even if it's for a moment. Mala, all the negativity, negative qualities, Arishat Vargas. Vikshepa, the unsteady mind, you see, it jumps from one thought to the other, like these insects and flies. They can't sit in one place. They keep jumping from one, flying from that kind of mind. It's a good mind, it's a pure mind. But it is an unsteady mind. Then also is not possible. After these two are crossed, then there is a avarana, deha bhava, the body consciousness, which is super, the consciousness of the self. And therefore it's very difficult to see. And all these other, all three conditions have to be fulfilled to understand anything of spirituality. If you don't know swaras, can you learn raga? If you don't know raga, can you deliver a kacheri? How is it possible? So if somebody says, no, I have negative qualities, I also have a fickle mind, nevertheless, I'm entitled to realization. I have a sad news for you, you are not. I keep saying, right, self-realization is your birthright. That is true. But to exercise your right, you have to undertake some responsibilities. Even a father won't give anything in inheritance to a bad son. Unless he deserves the inheritance, why would a father hand it over like this? Because he knows he will ruin it, he will squander it. So there are steps to it. We have a space between two things, between two perceptions, there is a gap. That is the gap where we are what we are truly are. I said you are seeing the, let's say I'm seeing the clock, it is 7:15. And then I shift my attention to the podium. Oh, this podium is made of wood and brown. Between I shift from the clock and I consider the podium as the next object to deliberate upon, there is a gap. That's a microsecond gap, let us call it. That gap is when I am what I am, because there are no thoughts at that time, there is no deliberations, no considerations, nothing in the mind. There is no negativity at that moment, no mala is there, no vikshepa is there, no avarana at that moment, because at that moment my mind is considering nothing, it's blank. But it is not so easy to catch that moment. It's not so easy to catch that moment. It's not a ball that I throw and you catch it on the other end. It is not that. It is like hitting a moving target. It's as difficult as that. A very, very adept shooter will be able to do that. A steady target, I can understand. A moving target, because your mind is moving between this and that. In that gap, I want you to catch hold of your mind. You think it is so easy? If it was so easy, everybody would have done it by now. That is why Tripura Rahasya, I'm enjoying that book. Because everybody goes through they have brought the whole book. Though it is supposed to be a lecture from Dattatreya, who is a Avaduta, who is a divine realized being, avatar of Vishnu, to Parashurama, who is also an avatar of Vishnu, Amshavatara. Parashurama is learning from Dattatreya and there are stories and so many things. So that is what it says. In that there is a story of Janaka Ashtavakra, they have a discussion and he says, see, this state we all experience every day so many times in a day, but we don't know. Unknowingly, we experience this state so many times in a day. When we are shifting our attention from one thing to the other and we go blank in between. And more so ever we experience this when a teacher shouts at us, mind goes blank. Or a question paper appears with a question you have no idea about, mind goes blank. They all are nirvikalpa samadhis. Do you know that? That is what Tripura Rahasya says. Swami says, hey, your mind goes blank, you are in nirvikalpa samadhi. Do you know that? No, it's not a joke, it is true. That state of mind, when you go absolutely blank, they gave example, how Dattatreya beautifully. When you suddenly meet your beloved after a long time, and in that embrace, you all thoughts disappear. Or suddenly you get a shock, shocking news that your bright young son has met with an accident and passed away. And that shock, that state when your mind goes blank, we say often, that is nirvikalpa samadhi. But then he jokes and says, what use if that nirvikalpa samadhi? For you don't even know that you experience that. It's like you're holding a beautiful, bright, white, shining stone in your hand. You don't know that it is diamond. How do you know its value? So such nirvikalpa samadhis are of no use. We just come in a moment and go. When our warden catches us red-handed doing some garbhar, or when Swami comes and yells at us or shouts at us or gives one angry look, we go blank. Those are also nirvikalpa samadhis. But are you trying for those? No, we are not trying for them. We want through savikalpa. Knowingly we should be able to attain that state. Unknowingly, by luck, that boy is saying, Swami will change my mind, something will happen. Thing is that even if I change the mind, he will go back to again his old ways. Because he has not done it with his will. It has just happened. Nirvikalpa, like what I said, fleeting nirvikalpa samadhi in a day, many times we have. Especially if he's a very bad student in the class, he'll be having in every hour some moments of nirvikalpa samadhi. Teacher says, you answer the question, samadhi. I don't know the answer. Completely blank he goes. Have you noticed that all of us have gone through that at some moment? Either a moment of shock, a moment of exhilaration, moment of, you know, uncertainty. We all have gone through that. You're going in a car super fast. Suddenly a dog crosses the road. You apply the brake and you've gone blank. Your hand, your Deha Bhava disappears. You don't even know your body exists. It's totally frozen. They are also nirvikalpa samadhis. But what use of these samadhis? Because they just come and go without even you realizing it. And you don't realize the bliss of it. It can come out of a state of shock also. Fear also. Uncertainty also. It could come for various reasons. But what I am saying, that the positive news that we have been experiencing and we are capable of experiencing it. But to make it happen at our will, that is the effort. For that, I said you should do some dhyana. I didn't even say dhyana actually yesterday. I just said you try practicing withdrawal. That is what we call in the Ashtanga Yoga, Yama, Niyama, Asana, Pranayama, Pratyahara we call it. To withdraw, quickly withdraw from any situation. And you are facing many issues, many things around you and you don't know, your mind is so disturbed. Your ego is hurt or somebody said something or you said something to somebody. Something unfavorable, unpleasant has happened. And you are agitated. Now how do you deal with that situation? Go over and give a slap to that person. Or you get slapped by that person. No. Withdraw. Like the tortoise, I give the example. This is the example Shankaracharya uses. Like the tortoise withdraws all its limbs at the sight of a danger. And goes into its protective shell. Like that you should be able to withdraw your senses and mind at that moment. I told only to practice that. Already I am getting doubts and questions. Swami, I tried this, but at that moment, I was not sure what happened. So I said, nothing happened, so don't be worried. All I was telling, withdraw your mind from your thought. That's all I am saying. That is the only step. I have not even gone till dhyana. I am still at pratyahara. But even to get pratyahara, the practice of withdrawal, it requires practice of breath, pranayama. That's why I said, concentrate between two breaths. Once you are breathing out and breathing in, there is a gap between the two. Prana, apana, vyana they call it, the vyana state they call it. Or you call it the state of kumbhaka, some people, by practice, you hold the breath. But what you are doing, your breath is directly connected to your mind. Like the voltage. Increase the voltage, the brightness, light goes brighter, isn't it? Decrease the voltage, the dims. Likewise, your mind and breath are connected. So these are very simple physical, biological, it's not even a spiritual phenomena. So very simple. When you're angry, how do you breathe? You know? Very fast breathing happens. Even when you're excited, you breathe very fast. But when you're calm, your breath naturally slows down. So whenever you go to a teacher with some great anxiety or to a doctor, he says, deep breathe. First you breathe deeply. That's what the doctors tell. If they want to check their pulse or if they want to check their issue, first they take a deep breath. So that your other interferences of your mind and psychology is not there in my diagnosis. Take a deep breath. My idea is that the breath controls the mind. It is very simple. It is like the steering wheel. So if you control the breath, you can control the mind. So what these saints do, they say they withdraw the breath and don't breathe at all. They practice this. People are there who can hold their breath for half a day, one day, without breathing. They can stay like that. What happens in that state? The mind loses all its power. It's like in the wind, the leaf is or a paper is floating. If the wind stops, paper will naturally come and settle down. So mind is like that paper which is floating in the wind of breath. So prana, to control that prana, mind will automatically die down. So that is what they use. They use the reverse method. By controlling the breath, control the mind. So I said, some people, you slow down your breathing. First thing is slow down. And then you try to find that gap between two breaths. Now don't choke yourself to death. No experience is coming, but I'm not ready to breathe out till I get the experience. You'll be found in the hospital then. That is not the idea. You have not reached that state. Don't try for something which you have not. If it's coming naturally to you, it's okay. But between the two breaths, there is a gap. In that gap resides the idea of blankness of mind. So blankness of mind is first thing. Vikshepa, the steadiness of mind. If there's a lake and you throw a stone, the water becomes unsteady. Even if it's a clean lake, you can't see because the reflection has got now distorted. You look at your face in the water, which is unsteady, it will also be moving. The reflection is moving. So you cannot see anything there. So you have to wait for the water to settle down steady. So that is why thoughts should be removed from the mind, and mind becomes inactive in the absence of prana, the breath, and therefore. But in a day we cannot do it. Somebody cannot just get up and run a marathon. There is a tremendous practice of building the stamina, building the strength. Then someday you can undertake a marathon. A 100-meter dash is not a marathon. So this process is a steady process. So don't just jump in. All I said is that withdraw. Withdraw means what I said. When such an agitation comes, try to withdraw your mind and observe your mind. Withdraw and what? Observe your thoughts. So I close my eyes now and my thought is, how did I sing the bhajan? Oh, that bhajan, that went wrong. So some thought has come already. Or somebody else, you know, that patient is here, she didn't come and meet me after the last consultation. So that thought has come. Or somebody's thought, you know, I cooked this thing in the morning and salt was less or more. Somebody else's get a thought, I went for playing today and I did not play well. See how many thoughts immediately crowd your head. Just observe them. That's all is withdrawal at that moment. So when you're agitated and something went wrong, and you withdraw and just observe your thought. See how my mind is trying to instigate me. It's trying to excite me, trying to make me feel terrible. Watch your mind as an external to you. Not as you. It's an external. That is what I say. This is my mind. My mind is different from me. This is my kerchief. Kerchief is different from me. So this is my mind. My mind, what it does? It influences my emotions. So I just observe from a distance. And what do? By distancing myself from the mind, I'm able to see it properly, what it is up to. Too close, I cannot see things clearly. Too far also, I don't know. I keep the mind at the right distance and observe my thoughts. Oh, okay, I am getting angry because that girl came and told this to me today. And that girl herself doesn't know anything and she is coming here to advise me. Or that person came and said such nice things to me. I am feeling so elated and excited. My ego is already one level up. So you are watching your mind. How your mind is influencing yourself. This is what I said, withdraw. Start there. Naturally, some people ask, can I do it anytime? Yes, by practice, yes. But initially, can you go on when you never learned how to ride a bicycle, can you go on a highway with a bicycle? You cannot. So you take an empty ground, ask somebody to help you so that you can practice and balance yourself. When the balance comes, even while doing all your, you can be talking and still riding a bicycle. You have no fear because you have got used to that. So a yogi, by continuous practice, gets used to withdrawal of the mind. Any moment, any time. But you don't try that because if you have not tried this before, if you have not put this effort before, you can't get it in a day. This is very unfortunate about spiritual aspirants. For everything else, they are ready to wait. They're ready to wait for 12 years to pass their schooling, 3 years to pass, get a graduation certificate, 2 years more to get a post-graduation certificate. But not even 20 minutes to realize. 10 minutes if they sat for meditation, they think the 11th minute realization should have come by now. For everything, they are ready to wait for 12, 15, 20 years. Realization should come in 10 minutes. How foolish is that? Is not ignorance? So set right expectations from your sadhana. Don't think that tomorrow it will come to me. No. And even if it comes like those fleeting nirvikalpa samadhis, it's no use. Because it's not in your control. This mosquito is flying. You keep clapping, gets hit, then hit, otherwise miss. That is not the kind of samadhi that your effort should be for. So all I'm saying is that don't rush into anything. So before we reach the stage of pratyahara, there is pranayama. Breathing slowly always helps, especially when you're agitated. Best thing to do is to just cut off from that space, because the energy of that space has already got angry energy is there. So leave the place. First thing, go to a place which is silent, calmer, right? Roll the door and sit down peacefully in a corner, and then deal with your mind, which is anyway going to agitate you from inside, but distance it from, and watch, like a mother watches the child make mischief. From a distance you watch. And then accept that it is a child. This mind is an immature mind which does not know how to deal. It has not developed equanimity, it has not developed equal-mindedness, so this is the way it will react to things. Accept that and deal with it accordingly. Distance it for some more time. Still it is troubling you, control your breath, calmer down, calmer and calmer and calmer. Even hold it for some time if you require. Not the ventilator stage, but at least to some extent. Then your mind will naturally settle down. After maybe for somebody it may happen in a minute, somebody may take half an hour. But after that it will naturally settle down. It is a natural phenomenon. But before pranayama comes what? When yama and niyama are there. You know yama and niyama. These are the rules of conduct in your personal life and in your social life. We are all living in a society. You have to behave in a certain way. Satya, ahimsa, asteya, aparigraha, brahmacharya. These are the rules that apply for the societal behavior. It means what? Satya, I must speak truth always. Asteya, I must not steal anything from anybody. Ahimsa, I should not hurt anybody in thought, word and action. I should not unnecessarily acquire and hide things for myself. I should not indulge in immoral conduct. If you control all these as an external phenomenon, then you come to the internal phenomena. That is even tougher. External, we can do it even out of fear of police or fear of bad name. Internal is purely in your hand. Nobody knows what's going on inside you. Put on white clothes, put vibhuti and give a smile. Nobody will know what's inside. So shaucha, purity, santosha, contentment with whatever we have. I didn't get 2 bhajans today. I didn't get half a bhajan. I did not get this. Swami didn't take this. Swami didn't do that. No contentment. Santosha. Tapas. Tremendous burning feeling to realize God. Tapa, tapana, tapas. That effort which goes when you have this tremendous burning feeling for realizing yourself, that is tapas. Swadhyaya, study of scriptures or attending a satsang or mananam of whatever you have heard or read. Digesting, assimilating, swadhyaya. Ishvara pranidhana, surrender to the divine. All these are the preconditions. It means you know swaras, you know aroha, you know avaroha, pakad. You know Lakshana Gita. Then you come to the main Chota Rakayal in Hindustani Raga. Then you think of Tilanas. So long way. Have you practiced Yama? Have you practiced Niyama? And if you have not done that, your mala is not gone. See, Yama and Niyama is to remove the mala. That is the impurity, like the dust on the mirror. You can't see your face. Some of our hostel mirrors must be like that. You can't see your face. Once I went to one hostel, the mirror had so many spots and stains that people had to literally see their face in one small place and comb them. I had to take one cloth, take some water, soap, sit and rub the mirror. Why you should struggle with that when your whole mirror is available to you? What is this foolishness to just look at that little spot and comb your hair? Take a little effort, clean the whole mirror. Whole mirror is there for you to see, and 10 people can see themselves in the mirror. That much space is there. But because of the mala, that much only is left pure in our minds. Rest all is cloudy, shaded, stained. So that is why mala. For that, removing mala, yama niyama is important. You sit down and think of each of these, satya, ahimsa, asteya, parigraha. All these things, you think that how this removes our mala, negativity, ahimsa, I don't want to hurt anybody. Satya, I don't want to tell untruth to anyone. Aparigraha, I don't want to take anything of anybody. Unnecessary, not hoard things. Means share, selflessly sacrifice. Asteya, not steal anything from anyone, not even the credit for what they do. Brahmacharya, my mind should always be engaged in the Brahman, and therefore I withdraw from all other physical relationships and pleasures. That is how the mind goes, Brahmacharya. Then you come to personal hygiene, Shuddhi. You should be clean outside as well as inside. Shaucha, Santosha, contented with what you have. Swadhyaya, and daily, sincerely, religiously, you must engage yourself in reading of the scriptures, attending satsang, engaging your mind and thoughts in some spiritual knowledge. Tapas, and then burn with the idea that I must realize self. Again, Tripura Rahasya, beautiful example. If a man has got burnt, let's say you burnt your hand in fire, are you going to think of how many marks you got in mathematics, or how did you sing the bhajan, or what is there for dinner today? When your hand is burning, what is that first thing you do? You run to find a balm. Isn't it? Nothing else you can think of at that moment. That kind of thinking. Burning sensation for God realization. Then you will not think of anything else. You straight, your focus is on where to find this balm to soothe my pain. That's all you can think of. That kind of burning sensation is tapas. Then you get into that effort towards that goal. And finally, ultimately, Ishwara Pranidhana, you have to surrender, saying that I am doing everything to the best of my ability, rest I leave it to you. Do your best, leave the rest. Ishwara Pranidhana. Tremendous faith in God that if I do right, He will definitely bless me. My efforts will not go waste. At the same time, Shraddha, you also have to have Saburi to wait for the right time for it to happen. After that comes Pranayama. You breathe. Because your mind has already become free of a lot of negativity, the mala, the dirt is gone. You have washed it clean, the mirror is shining. But unfortunately, it is not stable. It is shaking. So you're not able to see your hair and comb properly because the mirror is vacillating, moving. So what do you do then now to steady the mirror? That is Pranayama Pratyahara. Steadying the mirror. If a mirror is suspended by a rope, let us say, then what will happen? You have to go around the round and round to comb your hair because the mirror is turning this way, that way. Isn't it? So how to steady the mirror? Fix it on a wall. Then what happens? Then you don't have to do this dance to comb your hair. You can straight say, see yourself as. So clean the mirror, yama niyama. Steady the mirror, pranayama pratyahara. Pranayama means by breath control. It's like the wind which is shaking the mirror. Fix it by stopping that wind. It means controlling your breath. Not that you don't breathe at all, but slow down and slow down and slow down so much that there is only very little prana to shake your mind. So you steady the mirror. Pratyahara, now focus. Take out all the unnecessary reflections. There are so many things reflecting in the mirror, isn't it? Or not? If you put a mirror here, it will reflect. Probably this, I'll be reflected. Also, this chair will be reflected. Flowers will be reflected. Posts will be reflected. Wall will be reflected. But what do I focus on? If I have to comb my hair, I have to focus on my hair. Isn't it? Not even myself, my hair. If I see my eyes, can I comb my hair? I have to focus on my hair. That is pratyahara, to withdraw yourself from all other distractions and focus only on one thought. So that pranayama pratyahara. Then comes, you know, asana is also, there is a part of this only. Asana, why? Because you keep shaking your body like a vessel. the water inside also will shake. So steadily sitting in one place, peacefully, fixing your mind. If mirror is fixed but you are shaking, is that going to help you comb your hair? No. So you also have to be steady, mirror has to be steady, and all the other distractive reflections have to be ignored. Asana, pranayama, pratyahara. Then comes dharana. Dharana means, now focus your mind on combing the hair. You have got rid of, you have, what I have done, you have steadied yourself, you have steadied the mirror, you have removed all the reflections of the mirror. Now comes dharana. You are looking at not even your face, not even your nose, not even your eyes, not even your forehead, but your hair, which has to be combed. Or for a woman, let us say you have to put a bindi. So what will you look at? You will look at correctly in between the two brows, eyebrows, to put the bindi. You will not even look at the eyebrows. You will not even look at the eyes. You will not look at your nose, ears, cheeks, lips, chin, nothing. You will only look at the space where the bindi must go. Right? So that is what is called dharana. To focus. To dharana means to hold, to bear. So now you hold the image of your brumadhya to put the bindi. Dharana. Then the more you focus, now if you're holding this, then you have to focus and put the bindi here only. Means your hand should move according to the reflection that you're seeing. Now in between, suppose your asana changes, pranayama changes, the mirror will shake again. Your bindi will end up on your cheek or nose. Means all this time I'm keeping myself steady. I'm going to put the bindi, but I'm not able to do that till I have made sure all these steps are taken care of. Then I'm putting dharana, very focus to put. That focus turns into dhyana. Because I am my whole mind, my body, mind. Dhyana means what? Concentration. What is concentration? That is why I asked you. Where were you yesterday? You were here. Were you here in body, mind and spirit? Only body was there and mind was elsewhere, or your spirit was going elsewhere? Where your body is, that's where your mind is, that's where your heart is dhyana. Body you have studied through asana. Mind you have studied through pranayama, pratyahara. And all your devotion, all your effort now is to put the bindi correctly on your forehead. Dhyana, complete attention, every single. Imagine, you go and watch when a woman is putting a bindi on her forehead. She has no care for the world. She only wants to get the bindi right at the spot where she wants it. Or when a young man who wants to impress people with his hairstyle is combing his hair, let the wool fall and break into two pieces. Isn't it? Hey, water is calling, bell is ringing, suprabhatam, whatever, bhajan time. Bartaidini, bartaidini, bartaidini. Adu bidalla. Haudalla. He'll be the last to enter the bhajan hall because his combing is not yet perfected. So he's not satisfied. He combs and walks, array, this side is not good. Then he comes back again. Babu, bhajan hall, last bell is ringing. Coming. Dhyana, body, mind and spirit, nothing matters. Only that matters. What you are focusing on. What you are focusing on, the I am divine, that thought you are focusing on. That's all matters to you. Because all other distractions, everything has been removed. Mind has been steady, body has been purified and steadied. Breath has been controlled. And you have developed this thought that I must realize the self. And then all your body, mind and soul, you're completely focused on it. That's the bindi is being put now. Come to dhyana. Bindi is put, samadhi. You've achieved it. Haircut, hairstyle is perfect, achieved it. You're satisfied, you're happy, you're done with it. I'm explaining to you in your language so that you understand what these steps mean. Clean the mirror first of your mind. That is dirty. How can you do all this exercise will not work? Isn't it? So yama niyama. In daily life, how should I conduct myself in the society around me and also within myself when nobody is watching? And somebody is watching, we all can be good. Nobody is watching. It's only up to me what I am. I know my truth then. Then how I am? Yama niyama. Then comes asana. You can't be moving and comb your hair or put a bindi, so you steady yourself first. Asana. Also, asana has several roles because your body should be healthy. So people have taken yoga asanas to make sure that your body is healthy, because what you're trying to do won't happen in one sitting. You'll have to sit for long, but your back is aching, knee is aching, head is aching, hand is aching. How will you? Healthy body. So yoga asanas are required. But asana's main idea is to steady your physical frame. But also yoga asanas have been included for the simple reason that it keeps your body healthy and makes it capable of undertaking a sadhana. You're not suffering with too many pains or indigestion and headache and all kinds of aches. So you can spend time on this exercise. That is why asana. And then comes to pranayama. Holding the breath or controlling the breath. Start with just observing the breath. Not even slow down the breath. Just observe the breath. Then start slowing down the breath. Then come to the stage of holding the breath for some time. Till your mind reaches that state of steadiness. So your mirror is now steady and fixed. Now dharana, that thought, I am I. Dharana, bear that thought in your mind now, I am I. Then comes to dhyana. Everything else, to the exclusion of everything else, your body, mind, soul is totally involved in just that thought, I am I. Who itches, scratches, nothing matters. You don't even have that consciousness of the body. It's hot or cold, day or night, I'm in the room or I'm in the forest, doesn't matter, because your mind is totally cut off from the body by now. You see? Like you're putting the bindi. Everything you have cut off from. That time you're not thinking of what's happening at your feet, what is happening in your shoulder. All thought is that forehead and that bindi. That focused attention, dhyana. With that focused attention, you go and put the bindi. You have attained samadhi. This is savikalpa samadhi. With your efforts, with your knowledge, with your awareness, you have achieved this. Unaware, you didn't achieve it just because you were passing this way, that way, and somebody asked a question, you didn't know answer. That is not the samadhi I'm talking about. That is ignorant samadhi. But by continuously practicing savikalpa samadhi, what happens? A time will come when nirvikalpa samadhi will just come to you. Like a rider of a bicycle. Earlier he'll struggle to balance himself now. Now what will happen? Next time your mirror, everything is fixed and steady. You don't have to start the process of cleaning again next time when you want to go into samadhi. Everything is fixed. Your mind is clean, your body is pure, your conduct is perfect, moral. Your breath is slow, mind is steady. All these basics have been taken care of. So next time, what steps are left for you? Dharana, dhyana, samadhi. Now if dharana also is a part of you, that all the time you're only thinking of that thought and nothing else, then only dhyana and samadhi. You just focus on the thought a little bit and you're in samadhi. Isn't it? So that is what I am trying to say, that there's a process to everything. One Shirdi Baba story is there. One rich man, big miser, comes to Shirdi Baba. He says, I want Brahma Jnana. I want Brahma Jnana, he says. Shirdi Baba is Shirdi Baba. At least I am a little more polite. Shirdi Baba is blunt, upfront. If he doesn't like something, get out. He won't bear them for 1 minute. One ego in this insincerity, he won't bear for even 1 minute. That is Shiva. Satyasai, more social, more polite, more courteous. Even if they're troubling me, I bear them, saying that, okay, let it be. Shri Baba. So he was troubling Shri Baba. Give me Brahma Jnana, Brahma Jnana. He thought by coming to Shri Baba, he'll do something and you'll get Brahma Jnana, like our boy of Narasimhamurti, who thinks that Swami will change my mind. Why do I care? Now, if he has that kind of Param Bhakti, Marjala Bhakti, then I have no problem. But then Marjala Bhakti should show up in everything in his life. From his daily conduct, speech, thought, whatever thing. Not just when he is demanding Atma Jnana. But that won't happen. Anyway, that story. So this man was busting. So Shirdi Baba starts saying, he called Nandu and said, I need some 10 rupees, you know, 5 rupees, something. 5 rupees I want urgently. You go to that particular man and get. So this fellow runs there and comes back saying that, no, that man is not at his shop. I could not get 5 rupees. Oh, is it so? Okay, then you go to that particular house and ask them for 5 rupees. Again, that fellow Papam runs to get the 5 rupees from the other house. Again, he comes back and says, that person does not have. Shirdi Baba makes him run like this up and down. And this miser sitting there and thought, Baba, Brahma Jnana, Brahma Jnana. Then Shirdi Baba says to him, no, that Brahma Jnana is in your pocket. 5 rupees I've been asking for so long and you've been watching this. That I have been asking for 5 rupees. This is my guru to whom I have come for Brahma Jnana. He is struggling with some requirement and I have the money in my pocket. Yet he is not felt like offering it to Shirdi Baba. But he wants Brahma Jnana. Yama, Niyama, nothing. Samadhi. How is it possible? So that is why I said that you begin there. And why devotion helps you? Because mala, vikshepa, avarna, these things which I told just now. Mala is yama, niyama, it helps you. Selfless work, pure conduct in your daily life, behaving everywhere in the right way. Then comes the vikshepa, that is fickleness of the mind. Lot of prayers to God, that helps you to control your vagaries of the mind. Because you start with sakara bhakti, I said. You cannot just stare into the blank and control your mind. So you focus your mind on some god, some form, do this practice regularly. So that every time you close your eyes, Krishna only comes in front of your eyes, nothing else. So that practice of Sakara Bhakti helps you develop a little bit of this kind of a pratyahara, withdrawing from everything else and only focusing on dharana of Bhagavan's image. By continuous practice of that, your mind gets trained. A trained mind can do anything. See, once you know how to write, you can write a poem, you can write a paragraph, you can write a story, you can write a letter. You have developed the skill of writing or you have developed the art of speaking. You can speak whatever once you know the language. You can speak good things, bad things, nice things, not nice things. Likewise, once you have sharpened your mind and made it capable of going into that state of dhyana or dharana, then you can easily take it, you can focus that mind. That is why I said Atma Jnanis are more efficient in their work. Because they have such control on their mind and such thorough focus. Give them anything, they'll do it the best. Give them a song to sing, they will sing it the best. Give them a speech to give, they'll speak the best. Give them any work, if they put themselves into it, they'll do it the best. Because their mind is in their control. And they have sharpened the mind by focusing, like sharpening a pencil. So their mind is so focused. So whenever they want, I withdraw and I shift to God. I'm in God's state. Oh, suddenly I got a call. There is a trust meeting and we have to attend to some important decision. Okay, bring back the mind from there. Mind now focus on this trust affair. It focuses, it does that work, that's over. Next time there is a bhajan session going on, mind focus on how they're singing. Mind focus on how they're singing, gives me the feedback. Or somebody is speaking, mind focus on what they're speaking. It focuses on that. Mind focus on how the curtains are. Your mind is in your control. You can demand work from the mind. So I can always tell, that is when pratyahara truly is possible. When I say, mind, get back to me now. Give up all the other things and get back to me. It gets back to me. That's why I say, master the mind, be a mastermind. Not even a mastermind, be a master. Once you master the mind. That effort requires all these efforts of yama, niyama and all that stuff. Purifying your thoughts, purifying your actions, keeping your body, mind pure. These are all the basic prerequisites. These are alphabets to make a sentence. Giving a speech is far later. So this is the effort that will come. It may happen at some moments you might attain that kind of very pure state of thinking. You know, you came to bhajans, you saw Swami, you heard a nice bhajan, you forgot about all your vagaries, all the worries of the morning and the afternoon. And that may be in one bhajan, one sentence, one point in time, your mind came into that state. But these are all those fleeting samadhis, nirvikalpa, fleeting. Did you do it at your volition? Did you do it because you wanted to do it? It just happened that it came back to your mind for a moment. Again ran away next moment. And what is this? That's why when Hemachuda said to his wife Hemalekha, let me go back to that state of samadhi. In fact, I pity you. You know that such a samadhi exists and still you behave in the world like this. He was giving her lecture. Let me go back to that samadhi. I don't want to deal with the world anymore. She catches hold of his hand before he goes into meditation and tells, what is that samadhi which depends on just an inch long eyelid? With an inch long eyelid, samadhi comes and samadhi goes. What kind of samadhi is that? She says. That is not samadhi. But as you keep practicing this nirvikalpa, as I said, it is no use. This kind of nirvikalpas are no use, which come and go without your knowledge, without your control. Savikalpa is the method. Through dhyana, samadhi comes. Savikalpa means with your effort, with your knowledge, it comes. You are aware that you are in that state right now. But you continuously practice that, it becomes natural for you to get into nirvikalpa. You don't have to go through this whole process again. Next time, directly you can hit the bullseye. Because all this process you have done enough number of times. Straight away you can sing the song now. Because you have practiced. You are always ready. So nirvikalpa becomes a natural state for you then. And beyond that is a sahaja samadhi. Means you are always in that state. With eyes open, eyes closed, you are lying on the bed, you are standing straight. You are working, you are not working. In all possible ways there is an awareness as a background on which everything else is happening. You are always aware of the screen on which the pictures are moving. While everybody else will see these pictures, you see the screen also. I am saying this is, what is this? The table, isn't it? But is this not wood? What do we see now? First question I ask, what is this? You first thing you will tell is a table. But I would say it is wood. Because it's reality, it is wood. Mrittika eva sarvam. Shvetaketu Uddalaka tells, all the pots are made of clay. You may call it a pot, I will call it clay. Knowing that, everything is known. Knowing the clay, I know the pot. That's all, is the same thing you are seeing, I am also seeing the same thing. But I see it with a different attitude. You see it with a different attitude. You see this immediate present form. I see its originality. I see its reality. That's all is life about, the drishti. Srishti. So when you see each other, you see, oh, he's a boy, he's a girl, he's a man, he's a woman, he's a small child, he's an old man, he's so and so name. Because you're seeing the table. What I say? You're Atman. I am seeing the material with which all this is made. And I know all are same. Ah, this is a little bigger pot, this is a smaller pot, taller pot, shorter pot, that's all it is. Everything is pot only at the end. I know that you're all clay. That's all is the drishti of the jnani. He sees the original reality behind all the ephemerality. And therefore, sarva bhuteshu chatmanam tatona vijugupsute. The one who knows everything is me, he cannot hate anyone. Can you hate yourself? You get in the mirror and start scolding yourself. Maybe some psycho can do that. But you'll call him a psycho only, right? Madman, some issue, psychological issue. You know everything is you. How can you hate anybody? Yasmin sarvani bhutani, atmaiva bhudvijanataha. Everything is born out of the same reality, I, you and everything else. Tatra ko moha kashoka, ekattva manupashyataha. Where is the scope for such a person to have any attachment? I'm attached to my hand. Does it make any sense to you? I am attached to the nail of my toe. Does it make any sense to you? That's all it is. But to reach that state, a lot of purity is required, inner purity. Inner purity comes from yama, niyama, following the disciplines of life. From there, some of these practices to steady the mind, asana, pranayama, pratyahara. Then comes dharana. Focusing on that one single thought, that one forehead, one bindi. That's all. Nothing else should matter in the distract. Mirror reflects many things. But your focus is only on that. Dhyana. Focus becomes intense and intense as your hand moves towards your forehead. Your focus is becoming more and more and more intense now. At that moment when you are touching your forehead, there is nothing else that you are thinking of. It's just the bindi on your forehead, the vibhuti on your forehead. That's all. Nothing else at that moment. This effort is the effort towards attaining that state of blankness. And what happens at samadhi? No colorful lights, no sound, audio, video show, no sensations of all kinds. Many people write to me, Swami, I had terrible sensation in my hand, I had something happening in my head. I think something was going on between my eyebrows. I don't know what to answer. I said, maybe because you're strained perhaps yourself too much. You focus like that, you know, it starts paining, you think something is happening. strained yourself with both the eyes like this. So what happens, I don't want to joke about it, but you know, I'm not joking, okay? I can take refuge in Dattatreya. Dattatreya jokes about Hatha yogis. What he says, sometimes what happens, they tighten themselves too much, you know, because they want to push the prana through their Sushumna Nadi. So they hold all the breath and put all the effort, strain their muscles, perform all kinds of bandhas and push the air or prana, that prana, through the Sushumna Nadi, so that it rises the Kundalini, crosses the chakras and hits the Brahmarandra, and Hatha Yogi is that. So what happens when they do that, little also prana, if that enters, immediately their muscle relaxes and immediately their shoulders fall. Immediately they think that is joy out of the enlightenment. It might be just a physical relief from all the exercise and tightness that you did. Isn't it? So the example, he says, the feeling is like somebody has taken off a big bag from your shoulder. Big boulder or a burden from your shoulder. You feel relieved. But is that samadhi? That's also bliss. That's also joy. But that is because of removal of something, not because of attainment of something. So there are people who try all kinds of things. The best simple method, that is why I'm saying, do three things. In your hand, you have selfless work to do. That will purify your mind of all negativity. In your heart, tremendous devotion for God, love for God. And your mind, continuous discrimination. Which is right, which is wrong, which is real, which is not real. Which will take me towards God, which will take me away from God. Continuous smaranitya manichyata. So in your heart, always is filled with love for God. Your hands are serving God in all. In your mind is always discriminating between what is God and what is not God. In the sense, everything is God, but in the sense that this is not what I am seeking. This is what I am seeking. That difference. Ego is not God. So that kind of discrimination, continuously you must keep doing. If you do these three things, it is guaranteed your birth, as I said, your birthright is God realization. This birthright, there's nobody who can deny this from us. But we are denying it ourselves. So don't think it's not possible. In fact, somebody asked Sri Ramana Maharshi, what is the obstacle in realizing oneself? Ramana Maharshi, the classic, he said, the very thought that there is an obstacle is an obstacle. There is no obstacle. The thought that there is an obstacle actually. Otherwise, everybody is capable of realizing. So, idea is that yes, it is possible. Can you sing? Yes, you can sing, provided you have gone and practiced. You have done all your sadhana. Then you can sing. Can I pass the exam? Of course you can pass the exam, provided you have studied all your classes, done your homework, done your exercises, practiced and come. So can you do something or not? Yes, you can do that thing, provided you have done everything else that will lead you to that thing. Without doing any of these things, suddenly you cannot jump into knowing that. You want to swim. Can I swim? Yes, of course. Can I swim now? No. Why? Because that talent is within you. You can swim, but you have to bring it out by practice. Somebody simply jumps into a lake saying that if that man can swim, I should also be able to swim. He also has two legs, I have two legs, two hands, two eyes, jump. What will happen? Straight away he'll sink. So everything is possible, including this, provided you have done all this, brought yourself to that purity, control of mind, control of senses, and at the end, you're able to focus the mind on that one thought and realize that thought. So this whole process has to be followed. In one day, nothing will happen. One day has passed and you have no idea how many people have asked me and messaged me and wrote letters that, Swami, this is what's happening, that is what's happening. This is all much, much later. Have you got rid of all your attachments? Have you got rid of your egos? Have you got rid of all the differences of I and mine and thine and done? Okay, then let us start. But nevertheless, even in the times of agitation, control your breath, it will calm your mind down. You may not realize samadhi at that moment, but what it will do for you is that it will give you a samadhana. For that moment, you will be steady. You will think clearly, you will think right, and you will not make a mistake. At least to that extent, practice pranayama and pratyahara, even if it's not for the realization. But continuous practice of it, as you keep practicing your handwriting, you can write a poem, story, anything with it. So keep practicing this pranayama, pratyahara, niyama, yama. Asana means sitting in a place. If you're elderly, they cannot sit down, no need to sit down. But sit somewhere silently without moving. That is why asana is important. To get yourself comfortable, best asana is sukhasana. No? Better asana is, of course, shavasana. Any day. Flat and gone. Somebody said, what is the difference between deep sleep and samadhi? Deep sleep is deep sleep is your mirror is covered with a dark black curtain. That is deep sleep. You're not seeing anything. Lights off, curtain closed. That is deep sleep. You may come out saying that I experienced something amazing. I didn't know where I was. That's precisely the point. You didn't know. Whereas in samadhi, you know. When you come out of a samadhi, you still know that you are in a samadhi. But when you come out of deep sleep, you don't know it's afternoon, evening, morning. You don't know. You have to be reoriented. So that is what it is. So your asana is important. Sukhasana, sit steady, straight. And to sit steady and straight, you need a healthy body. And for that, you need to do other yogasana that helps you to keep your body healthy. Today, all kinds of games and exercises are there. But what games and exercises were there for rishis? So they simply use this. Basic yogasanas to keep their bodies healthy. The digestion's intact, the respiration in order, the circulation in place. So that they can spend time in one steady position and learn. All right. So I'm explaining this because I don't want you to jump guns and get into something and start getting disappointed already. Now please take time. This is not something that will come to you in 10 days. It might have come to Dhruva, Markandeya, Nachiketa because of many births of penance. I'm not saying you have not done penance for many births. But to even to revise your syllabus, you see, for a whole year, it takes an hour to revise, isn't it? Yeah, you have studied, I'm not saying you didn't study the whole year. But before exams, it takes time to revise. So it will take some time to revise and refresh your old memories, old efforts. But nevertheless, it is possible.
प्रेमामृत बरसाओ बाबा
प्रेमामृत बरसाओ बाबा
प्रेमामृत बरसाओ बाबा
कैसा जीवन
तुम्हारी दया
करो भगवान, दया करो भगवान, कृपा करो भगवान,
कृपा करो भगवान।
प्रेमामृत बरसाओ बाबा,
प्रेमामृत बरसाओ बाबा,
दया करो भगवान,
दया करो भगवान,
कृपा करो भगवान,
कृपा करो भगवान।
तुम्हारी दया बिन कैसा